Live Home 3D for Mac provides its users with the ability to export highly realistic 3D views with the help of Radeon ProRender or Cycles rendering engines. Radeon ProRender is covered in a separate tutorial. In this one, we'll talk about Cycles. This rendering engine creates accurate lighting and material renders with the help of path tracing algorithms. However, in order to get stunningly realistic results, first you need to understand the settings of the rendering engine and which ones you should use to achieve the desired image. To start using it, select File, Export, Render with Cycles in the main menu.
Note that most of the default rendering settings do not require changing unless you're rendering demanding scenes, which will be covered in this video. Render devices and CPU threads. The first category that you encounter in the opened window is Render Devices, which lists the available devices for rendering, i.e. CPU or GPU. If your device does not have a standalone graphics card, only the CPU will show in the list. The CPU threads parameter determines how many processing threads will be used for rendering. Increasing the number of threads can speed up the process of rendering with the CPU, but it can also affect the performance and stability of the system and the use of resources. In most cases, you will only achieve the maximum speedup of the rendering process by using the Graphics Accelerator, GPU, since it is designed specifically for handling complex graphics calculations. Camera and resolution. The camera drop-down list contains all cameras available in the current project. Here you can choose the camera with the view that you want to render. Resolution controls allow you to either choose one of the predefined dimensions of the image or to set the image width and height manually. The higher the resolution, the more detailed the rendered image will be. However, rendering an image with higher resolution also requires more time and resources. A higher resolution can be useful for printing and for large screens, while a lower resolution is suitable for publishing online and viewing on smaller screens. Render samples and tiles. The render samples setting is the major factor that determines the quality of the rendered image. The larger number of samples for a pixel is what provides the best results, but it requires more time for calculation of the colors. By default, the render processes all pixels in the image for calculating the samples. The image looks grainy and noisy at first, but gradually improves as the rendering engine calculates the additional samples. This approach requires more memory and CPU resources, but it allows you to pre-watch the whole image during the process and stop it when you're satisfied with the results or if you decide to make adjustments. This method is recommended for small or medium-sized images. If you need to render a high-resolution image or your device does not have sufficient memory, choose the Use Tiles option. In this case, the application breaks the large image into smaller tiles and renders them one by one. With the help of the Size parameter, you can set up the sizes of tiles. After the render is complete, you can save the resulting image. Or you can stop it and save at any moment if you're satisfied with the results.
If the image appears too noisy, you can either increase the number of samples or use the denoise filter and render again. Unlike the denoise filter, tone map filters apply to the rendered image and can be previewed immediately.
These filters use the power of light to highlight or hide some tones and accents. Depending on the filter, you can change contrast, saturation, exposure, and other parameters. Advanced rendering settings. Apart from the resolution and number of samples, there are other settings that have an effect on the rendering speed and quality. They're hidden in the Advanced section. Let's have a closer look at them. Note that you can't see the effect of the changes in these settings without rendering. The Environment Light Intensity parameter allows you to set the brightness of sunlight and moonlight. Increasing this parameter can help you render indoor scenes where daylight is intended to be the main source of light. If the outdoor scene is too bright, decrease the value of this parameter. Note that if there is no or little daylight in the scene, you'll need to change the brightness of lamps in your project to add more light. Max Ray Diffuse controls the maximum number of reflections of rays. The rays of light come out of light sources and travel through the scene, reflecting and refracting on different surfaces. Each reflection creates new rays that keep traveling through the scene. Setting a higher value of this parameter allows you to achieve reflections and lighting that look more realistic. However, this can greatly increase the rendering time. The value that needs to be set for the Max Ray Diffuse depends on the rendered scene. If the scene contains many plants, for example, or mostly rough surfaces, we recommend setting the value to 30 or more. The Max Ray Glossy parameter uses the maximum number of reflections of rays with the glossy, shiny surface. The glossy surfaces are the ones that have shiny properties, i.e., glass, metal, or a smooth paint. When a ray of light reaches such a surface, it doesn't precisely reflect in one direction. Instead, it scatters to some degree, creating a shiny or reflective effect. This parameter defines how many times the rays can reflect off of the glossy surfaces. Increasing the value of this parameter can make the gloss and reflections appear more detailed, which in turn makes the materials look more realistic, but at the expense of rendering time. We recommend that you leave the default value at 5 unless you're not satisfied with the look of your glossy surfaces. The Max Ray transmission parameter limits the number of times a ray of light interacts with a transparent or refracting material. This is important when working with objects with transparency or those that refract light, such as glass, water, transparent plastic surfaces, etc. Setting the value too low can make the render look unnatural, while higher values may increase the time of rendering without any noticeable improvement in the quality of the image. While the default value should be enough, you might want to increase it if your scene contains many transparent or reflective surfaces. The Max Ray Transparent parameter controls the number of times that the ray of light can pass through transparent surfaces in the scene. It is similar to Max Ray Transmission, but applies specifically to transparent surfaces. Setting a lower value for this parameter can make transparent objects in the scene less transparent, which may be useful for simulating muddy glass or highly refractive materials. While a higher value improves the rendered image in some cases, it also increases the rendering time and might even contribute to a higher level of noise that may occur due to complex geometry and certain materials. Indirect light clamping controls the brightness of indirect lighting in the scene. It can help in rare situations where bright sunlight produces overexposed areas, so-called fireflies. We recommend using the default value of this parameter if you don't have any specific requirements for your render. In the adaptive sampling mode, noisier regions are identified and have more sampling iterations. Sampling stops in areas where the level of noise is below the noise threshold value. We recommend using the adaptive sampling mode in most cases. If you set the noise threshold to 0, it is equivalent to switching adaptive sampling off, and the number of samples for all regions will correspond to the render sample's value. A value of 1 means that rendering will be finished when the noise is almost completely eliminated from the scene. The Backfaces Displacement functionality is designed for fixing problems with objects where front and back surfaces lie in the same plane. If you notice that parts of a 3D model are visible in the real-time rendering but look dark or black after rendering with cycles, you can try enabling this option.
So that's basically what you need to know about the settings, which you can use to fine-tune your renders. Here are some tricks that may also help you achieve stunning results in rendering. Add some light sources that are not visible in the picture. It will bring more light to the scene and produce a more realistic rendering. Set the time of day to morning to get longer shadows. The realistic effect of the rendered scene highly depends on favorable light and shadow combinations. Give preference to physically based materials, PBRs, in the scene. Either ones from the material library of Live Home 3D or your own materials. Otherwise, the rendered image may not be that different from the simple screenshot. Use emissive materials instead of lamps whenever possible, e.g. LED strips, furniture with a slight illumination, luminous decorations in the kids' room, etc., to achieve a more realistic look and avoid overexposure. Now that you know all the theories, let's start rendering.